This is Beyond the Big Screen Podcast with your host, Steve Guerra.
I would like to welcome a very special guest today, Trevor Rowley. Trevor has combined his love of education, landscape, architecture, and archaeology to study a variety of topics. Today, we are going to focus in on one of the most fascinating groups of all times, the Normans. And Trevor is also the author of The Normans, A History of Conquest. Can you tell us a little bit about your background? Because I think it's a really fascinating perspective on your background on how you write about the Normans.
Right, Stephen. Yes, I was born in Shropshire in the Welsh Marches, an area where the Normans are present in today, because a large number of buildings, churches and castles and so on. And when I went to university, I read geography to begin with, but I moved very rapidly towards history, historical geography, landscape history, and I found myself doing archaeology as well. And all of this I put together within a career in lifelong learning. I worked for the continuing education department of Oxford University. That's lifelong learning. And there we were very keen on spreading the gospel, as it were, of archaeology, of landscape history, and the Normans. So I had an ideal background from which to work, education, and with people who were interested, and also working with groups who we could work in the field with as well. I retired and then I continued. I specialised more on the Normans since I retired because I've given my days of digging are over, although I still do a bit of field work, but actually, on my knees, I can't do that. So I write rather than dig.
In the very broadest strokes, who are the Normans?
Well, the Normans are, they start off as Vikings and they come down to England to begin with, into Ireland, but they then move into the Seine Valley in northern France, and they set up a territory, a principality, or at least they are set up by the incumbent Carolingians, who see them both as a serious enemy because they plunder their way up the River Seine, but they also see them as a possibility of blocking off that area, the Seine Valley, from further incursion. So they grant the Vikings an area of the Seine Valley on condition that they will stop more of their own coming in. And then the subsequent story of Normans is that they take over what becomes Normandy, but they also adopt a large amount of the culture of the existing French Carolingians.
That's one of my main questions, is how does a Viking Scandinavian become a French Norman in such a short amount of time? What were maybe some of the cultural influences and the pushing and pulling of culture that made this seemingly rapid change in culture for them?
That's a very good question. They come in as looters and raiders. But you can only loot and raid so many times. So they then begin to settle down. They begin to become respectable. And I think one of the big questions is how many Vikings were there compared to the indigenous French population. We don't know the answer to that, but it was probably only about one in 10, one in eight, quite a small percentage. But they were in charge. They were the rulers. And they then saw the advantage of really adopting Carolingian French laws, French systems of government, and of course the language, because Viking was not a written language. And if you wanted to run a country, then you needed to have a written script which you could correspond and lay out taxes and so on. So they rapidly saw the advantage of becoming French, And so there is a sort of almost concerted effort by the ruling Viking classes to become French as quickly as possible, because in doing so, they then had the advantage of being able to intermarry in within French society, the whole of French society, and to be able to communicate with them on equal terms. So I think that that is one of the big motivations, that they want to be, they want to become respectable, because being respectable is, it means money, means wealth, means prestige.
What were some of the cultural aspects that maybe these Norman French hung on to the from their Viking era?
Well, it's a, that again is a very good question, because archaeologically, the Vikings are very quiet in Normandy. They're not so quiet in England. We know we can pick them up in England, but in Normandy, they're not obvious at all. The most obvious evidence for them is in place names. There are hundreds of place names which have a Viking element. Toft, Lund, Hog, all of these elements are integrated into Norman names, often with a French suffix, that is, ville, like Toteville is an example, where Toft is the Viking for a homestead, and ville means just a village. So that's their most obvious in the place names. The language itself dies out quite quickly. It probably survives into the 11th century, but not really much before beyond that. It wasn't a great cultural asset to be a Danish speaker, really. It was much better to be a French speaker or a Latin speaker. One or two other elements hang on. There is, for instance, a slave market in Rouen, right up in the 11th century. And that's a hangover from the Viking days, because they're still dealing in slaves. There's also a political link with the Vikings, which the Normans hang on to. Until about the same time, about 1010, 1020, they allow free access to the Seine for Viking forces. Viking forces that are on their way south, they will give them safe harbour. That stops again about 1020, when they are very much part of the mainstream of northwestern European politics.
In the grand scheme of things, though, that's a very short amount of time. When did the Normans establish themselves, or when did the Vikings establish themselves in Normandy, and how did that happen?
What happens is that, as I say, to begin with, at the end of the 9th century, they're busy looting, raiding, and raping their way up the Seine, particularly hitting monasteries, and then going back to Scandinavia. And then beginning to overwinter, and then in 911, the Western French king, a man called Charles the Simple, although it doesn't mean exactly that he was simple, it means he saw things in a straightforward way. He granted them land through a treaty called the Treaty of Saint Clair sur Epte. And this was basically the land around Rouen, which was the ancient capital of the region. And a man called Rollo becomes the Count of Rouen, effectively the first Duke of Normandy, because William the Conqueror is about five generations further on. So it is a very short time span. He becomes Christian, or ostensibly he becomes Christian, and as I say, he takes on this responsibility of looking after the western part of the Frankish Empire in return for the land and the position. So I'm not sure if that answers your question, really.
Yeah, I think that also leads into my next question about Christianity. How quickly did the Vikings who became Normans adopt Christianity, and how deeply did they infuse Christianity into their culture?
Again, an excellent question, because as you know, the Vikings at this stage were certainly pagan. And they made a beeline for churches, monasteries, because that's where wealth was kept, and they sacked them all the way down the river. One of the clauses in the Treaty of St. Clair was that Rollo and his followers should be converted to Christianity. And there are there's a lot of myths around this, but one of the stories that I like is that they did adopt Christianity, but they enjoyed it so much that they often lapsed. They enjoyed the conversion process, that they lapsed, and then they were converted again several times. The story about Rollo himself on his deathbed, that he had a mass said for him, but just to make sure, he had a number of human sacrifices as well.
Oh, wow.
So I think that's apocryphal, but nonetheless, I think it sort of underlines this this tension between the two. And the Christianity in Normandy during the first decades of the Viking takeover is very quiet, very, very quiet. And we don't see churches being resurrected much until the middle to the latter part of the 10th century. But one of the really interesting things that I find is that the Normans, who start off as pagan looters and raiders, become some of the most enthusiastic Christians in the whole of the Latin West. They become really torch holders for pure Latin Christianity by the middle of the 11th century. And by the time of the conquest of England, they are actually, they use the conquest of England as a sort of almost as a crusade. They sell it to the Pope, saying, look, these people in England, they really got a backward Christian religion. We'll take the real stuff over there and reform this backward Christianity. And so the Pope actually endorses the invasion of England on the basis that William will bring Christianity back, the pure Christianity back to the English.
That's a great point that really helps get into my next question, because it's kind of the big thing one of the biggest things that the Normans did. They did many things, is the conquest of England. How much would have an Anglo-Saxon in the mid-1000s think of the Normans? Are they thinking of them as just another version of the Vikings coming in, or are they seeing them as a movement of the continent and of the Carolingians and the Franks?
Well, I think the average Englishman in 1065 would have known very little about the Normans. It's not true to say there weren't links. There were links with the monarchy. A Norman, Emma, had been married to two kings of England, to Ethelred the Unready and to Canute. So there were, at sort of aristocratic monarchical levels, there were links. But I don't think really anybody knew much about Normandy, apart from those people who traded with it on the south coast. So I think there would have been a great deal of ignorance about the Normandy. I think it would have come as a great surprise when William ends up as King of England to the vast majority of English people. I don't think they would have even known that he had ambitions to become King of England, or there was a story that Edward the Confessor had promised him the throne. I don't think any of those things would have percolated very far down the social scale.
And now, a brief word from our sponsors. The Normans, they came in and made huge cultural changes. Were there big changes that archaeologists and experts today can see in the material culture between Anglo-Saxon times to Norman times? Was there a big effect on that culture?
On the surface, very little. If you dig a site of the 11th century, you will not find any change in the pottery or the majority of artifact. At a sort of bigger level, there obviously are. The architecture changes. The Normans introduced castles. So there are big changes, but not at the sort of basic level. So, as I say, for most people at the peasant level, there would not have been a great deal of obvious material change, although there would culturally, there would have been very big change.
I think that most of the people listening today have a lot of familiarity with the Normans in England. But one of the things that I think is not as well known, even if people are aware of it, is the Normans in the Mediterranean and their interactions in southern Italy and the Byzantine Empire. How did a group of Vikings who went to Normandy, and then how did they get to the Mediterranean and set up an enormous and powerful kingdom there?
Yeah, I think you're quite right. Most people associate the Normans with William the Conqueror, 1066 and all that. But there is a completely, there's another totally different story about them in the south. The conquest of England was undertaken by the king, mobilizing the whole of the resources of his territory and bringing in allies. And it was a major project led from the top downward. The activities in the south, in Italy and Sicily in particular, they were much more piecemeal, and they happen on a much slower time scale over decades rather than in 1 year in 1066. With Normans going on crusade to Jerusalem, and they, in order to get to Jerusalem, they used to travel through Italy and take the ship over from Italy to sort of Greece, the Greek area, travel across Greece and down to Turkey and down to Jerusalem. So it was the process of pilgrimage, of which they were very keen, and they went, because of the general circumstances, they went as armed pilgrims in order to protect themselves and perhaps even to sort of to get hold of supplies on their way. And the south of Italy was a bit of a mess in terms of its politics in the 11th century. There were Latins from Rome. There were Byzantines. A lot of Greeks were over in there. There were Greek territories over there. There were some from the north, Lombards, and there were Muslims, particularly in Sicily, which was still under Muslim control at this time, but also in southern Italy, there were enclaves of Muslims, and they were all out there at each other's throats from time to time, in a series of city-states. They didn't have an overall national identity at all. The power lay with the city-states, and what the Normans did, they were then employed as mercenaries because they were seen as being powerful cavalrymen on their horses, and they were then enlisted to help one side or the other. And gradually they acquired land, and they acquired land, and they then acquired they acquired dukedoms and countdoms down there, and eventually they were able to take over the whole of southern Italy. And they were able to take over Sicily. Again, a long process, but they then end up as kings in Sicily. They are recognized as the rulers of a Christian Sicily, and they are given the title king. So you see, they start there as very modest noblemen, very, very low-level noblemen from no better really than local farmer lords looking to make a buck, and they did. They became very wealthy.
Another question that I had, especially from reading your book, is that you have Vikings who are sea warriors who really make very little use of cavalry, and within a few short generations, they've almost completely lost the ability to travel by sea, and then they're the most proficient cavalrymen, and they adopt an entire cavalry mindset in just such a short amount of time. How did that happen, and how much do we know how that developed?
Yeah, well, that's again a very, very good point. The basic thing was that once they got hold of the land territory of Normandy, their problems were all land-based all around them. There was Flanders to the north, there was the sort of rump of France to the east, and there was Brittany, there was Anjou. All of these were potential enemies who from time to time would gang up on them. And so they had to use the Carolingian system of warfare in order to succeed. And so they adapted to that very quickly. They had no real use for a navy after they were there, basically. At that stage, they hadn't got their eyes on England. They really needed to protect their own borders. And to do that, they adopted this system of castles and cavalry. And they adopted the Carolingian military system, which relied heavily on horse-based fighting. One of the things that they did do, and what they were extremely good at, was that they recognized a good thing when they saw one. And they were able to bring in horses from Spain in particular, where they were also fighting. And they were able to bring in horses from the Muslim world, from North Africa, and they were able to train them up. And they trained them up into fighting horses. And they had very good horses, and they became well known. In fact, I think Normandy still is known for its stud farm. But that was one of the features about the Normans was they were so good at being eclectic by recognizing things which were useful to them and adopting them and adapting.
Did the Normans carry that on into southern Italy and Sicily when they conquered there?
Indeed, yes, they did. They went down as horseborn men down to southern Italy, and they used cavalry, which of course again down. Well, there was some Byzantine cavalry down there, but for the most part, they were on their own. But they also, adapt, adopt, and amend was more or less the Norman catchphrase, and that's what they did with enormous skill.
What did the Normans adapt from Muslim culture in Sicily and southern Italy to help themselves?
Well, initially in Sicily, they were very, very cosmopolitan. They used Greeks and Muslims for medicine, the Latins for law, and so on in their courts. But gradually they became very northern European, and those facets changed. What you do see, and you still see today, is the influence of Muslim architecture in the great churches of Sicily: Palermo Cathedral, Cefalù Cathedral, Monreale. All of these have a very, very large element of Muslim architecture. Echoes down the ages. One of the other things they adopt, and there's a sort of spillover into England, is that they become very interested in gardens, for instance. Not gardens for producing produce, but gardens as aesthetic places, which was part of the Muslim philosophy. But because the Muslims loved Sicily because there was so much water there and they could use water. And we find that is something that is brought up into Northern Europe. And we find, for instance, perhaps Henry I and Henry II introduce these gardens around their palaces at places like Woodstock. We know that they also introduce a menagerie of animals, wild animals, which are brought in from Europe and Africa. And this, again, is a Muslim characteristic, sort of widening the vision of the world to show other features, other unknown elements that are brought together. And the idea of having aesthetic landscapes around a castle is not something you normally associate with the Normans, but it is something that they do introduce at a fairly early date. And that's a Muslim characteristic.
What would have been the links between the southern Italian, the Mediterranean Normans, to the Normandy Normans, to the Normans in England? Did they have, what degree of cultural connections did they have?
Yeah, there were links. There were certainly family links. There would be families in England who had had relatives in France and in southern Italy, and that included the monarchy. Henry II's sister was married to the King of Sicily, for instance. But there were no really strong political links. There were between England and Normandy up to 1204, but there were no strong political links with the South in any real terms. Although one of the interesting things is that if you take by the second out of the second half of the 12th century, when Thomas Becket is murdered in Canterbury, he immediately becomes a sort of favorite Norman saint. And you can find him in Monreale within pictures of him within 6 years of his martyrdom. So that sort of cultural link is obviously very strong indeed.
Kind of the last step of the Normans in their travels is in the Crusades. What impact did the Normans have on the Crusades?
Yeah, again, very, very, very interesting. The Normans participated in the Crusades in two different groups. That is, the group from Normandy itself, William the Conqueror's son, Duke Robert, took a contingent, which was largely made up of northern French crusaders. And that was very successful because it participated in the various sieges, the siege of Antioch, and in particular in the siege of Jerusalem. And on the way down, Robert picked himself up a wife in southern Italy. But in the long term, they didn't stay very long. The southern Italian contingent who were involved were much more influential because they actually set up a crusader state in Antioch. And there are Norman kings or Norman princes in Antioch right up until the 13th century. They probably didn't bear much relationship to William the Conqueror, but they were still part of that lineage that went through right to 1095 when they established that crusader state. So they were very active participants, and they did have that long-term effect on the politics of the region. And the impact was very considerable. Just on the side, England itself did not participate in the First Crusade. So Norman England, what happened was that William II, that's William the Conqueror's son, paid a mortgage of £5,000 for Normandy. Duke Robert mortgaged Normandy in order that he could raise the army to go on crusade. And that really gave the English Normans a very strong hand in moving back into Normandy later on. Also, the Sicilian Normans didn't participate because they were too close at that stage to the Muslims in Sicily. They were still working very closely with them, and so they didn't participate really on sort of philosophical lines. They wanted to coexist rather than attack. But those two other Norman elements were very strong and important indeed.
By this time in the 10th century, 11th century, this is really the high watermark of the Muslims, their conquests into southern Italy and into the Mediterranean. And it really seems that about this time that they start to recede. Would the Normans have been the impetus of this, or was it maybe problems that they were having internally and the Normans were maybe one of the factors that just kind of started that process?
The Normans participated. The Normans really used the unsettled situation in southern Europe and the Crusades. They were great, as I say, what they did with great alacrity was to use any situation to their own advantage. And that's what they were doing in these circumstances.
Maybe a couple of last questions. I think one of the most important things is, what relevance do the Normans have for us today?
Yeah, again, a very, very good question. Well, I think in terms of the English-speaking world, the Normans actually are the beginning, as it were, year zero, because we, in this country, we traced the William the First. He's the first sort of English king that's recognised, if not Edward the Confessor. And many families would claim they go back to the Normans. There's a very strong element within English-speaking culture, which is Norman-based or French-Norman-based language, for instance. We speak a language of which about 20% of the words are French-based, or have a French element to them, many of which we wouldn't recognise, but that is true. And it was the Normans who essentially brought that into the English language. I mean, it's not as simple as that, because French continues to be spoken at a courtly level for much longer than the Normans. But nonetheless, it's the Normans who bring it in. A number of other elements of culture, architecture, the Romanesque, the reintroduction of classical Romanesque building is enormously important and echoes down the ages. And you in America have many buildings which have a heart, the Romanesque of the Normans, the sort of use of rounded arches and so on. Literature also changes with language, and much English literature changes. The change to Middle English is propelled by the Normans coming in. It changes the whole culture. And there are other things I could point out, perhaps less tangible. I think in this country, we would say perhaps even the whole concept of hierarchical class, which is often associated with the British, starts with the Normans. I'm not sure it's absolutely true, but you know, I think there's a concept that's the case. Place names: Montgomery, Richmond, Beauville, Beauvoir, and so on. All these are place names which we owe to the Normans. So I think there's a very rich element there. A lot of it is below the surface, but it's there nonetheless. But in terms of, if you want me to ask me what their biggest contribution was in this country, in England, then I would say the architecture and the refashioning of towns like Norwich and Lincoln and Durham, all of which whose heart is Norman, Canterbury, is Norman in essence, because they re-changed it out with their castles and cathedrals and bishops' palaces. They relayed them out, and they're still there today, the basic plan. So there's a lot of Norman about us.
And now, a brief word from our sponsors. Norman history is absolutely filled with huge personalities. Who are some of your favorite personalities?
Yeah, I do. My own favorite is William the Conqueror's half-brother, a man called Odo, Bishop Odo of Bayeux. He is the man who probably was responsible for commissioning the Bayeux Tapestry, this extraordinary it's an embroidery which is in Bayeux, which shows the story of the conquest of England. He was made bishop by his brother when he was very young, probably as young as 16, because William was putting his own men into powerful positions, and the church was a powerful force. And so he is one of the people who is seen as an architect of the invasion. On the Bayeux Tapestry, he's seen on several occasions giving advice to William, like, for instance, say, why don't you build a new fleet, and so on. So he's shown as quite a big character. After the conquest, he becomes one of the biggest landowner after the king in England, and he's regent when William returns to Normandy. But he's never quite satisfied. And so in 1082, he's seen raising a private army in England. And we think he was intending to go to Rome to seize the papacy, that he wanted to become Pope, and that he was going off to in the Isle of Wight. He'd raised this navy and army and was about to take off when William found out, arrested him. And for the last 4 years of William's life, he had his brother incarcerated in Rouen. So he's completely out of favour. When William died, on William's deathbed, he released him. But he's said to have said, "You'll be sorry that I've done this." And then within a year or so, Odo had again rebelled against the English king, William II, William Rufus, and he was exiled as a result of that, back to Normandy. He became a sort of close associate of Duke Robert, and in 1096, he went off on a crusade. He actually joined the crusade largely because he was going to get done in if he'd stayed in Normandy, because Henry I, as he was a very powerful character, and he'd fallen out completely with Henry by imprisoning him. So you can see he's a man of considerable interest, colour, and whatever. And then eventually he leaves the crusade in Italy and goes on to Palermo in Sicily, and he dies in Palermo in Sicily in 1096. So in many ways, he reflects the energy, the ambition, the sort of almost boundless ambition of the Normans. So, I mean, he's not a man I think I would have personally liked to have dinner with on many occasions. However, he was a fascinating personality.
I have to ask one more question about the bio tapestry. Was that something that was common in that time period? Why would Odo have a gigantic tapestry created instead of maybe having a text written?
Well, yeah, tapestries were much more common than we think they were, because most of them have disappeared. There are little fragments here and there. The Bayeux tapestry is very interesting because it survives, because it was kept in Bayeux Cathedral in a chest and only shown for 2 weeks each year, and then bundled back into this chest. So therefore, for most of the year, it was protected. So that's one of the reasons why it survives, as opposed to the other ones, which all sort of erode away. But the point behind the Bayeux tapestry was that I think Odo wanted to show the story of the conquest in a very graphic light. In a way, the Bayeux tapestry underlines the whole enigma of the Normans, because it was undoubtedly undertaken at the direction of the Normans. The storyline is the Normans, the Norman-owned storyline. There are elements which might be English subversion, but let's forget about that. But certainly it was woven by English craftspeople, English, probably mainly English women, in England, in Canterbury. So it was a sort of a really joint venture, but where the Normans are calling the shots, but the actual work is being done by the English. And in many respects, that really underlines what happens throughout the whole story.
It's probably hard to put a monetary value, but in terms of a project, how big of a project would that have been? And what kind of resources would that have required? I mean, I imagine it must have been a tremendous.
The Bayeux tapestry?
Yes.
Yeah. The tapestry would have employed dozens of seamstresses, of workers, in a workshop in Canterbury Cathedral, or St. Augustine's, more likely, in Canterbury. And there would have been a large number of researchers working on the different elements to it. It would have been a very costly, quite right, very, very costly. They would have had to have all the dyes brought in from different parts of Europe to bring out the right colours. So it would have been a very costly. But to the Normans, you see, they had won the jackpot. They had become rich with their conquest of England. They had a country 10 times as large as their own, and probably 10 times as rich. And they were top dogs. It was their money. So they weren't worried about that. That was all part of the game. That's why they were able to build these great cathedrals, Durham Cathedral, Lincoln Cathedral, Rochester Cathedral, all these grand Romanesque buildings, all these grand Romanesque castles they were able to build, because the labour was, I say, dirt cheap. It was very, very cheap, if it costing anything, and they had all the other resources to buy in the goods to in order to do it. So they were able to afford these things because they were the winners.
Thank you again for listening to Beyond the Big Screen. A huge thanks goes out to Trevor Rowley, author of The Normans, A History of Conquest. Links to learn more about Trevor Rowley and how to find his books can be found in the show notes. A great way to support Beyond the Big Screen is to leave a rating and review on Apple Podcasts. These reviews do a ton to help me know what you think about the show and, of course, help other people learn about Beyond the Big Screen. Don't keep the big secret to yourself. If you'd like to reach out to me, you can connect with me and other people who want to learn more about the movies they watch and great stories that could very well easily be movies on Facebook and Twitter by searching for A2Z History. You can contact me there or just send a good old-fashioned email to steve@a2zhistorypage.com. Links to all of this and more can be found in the show notes or at my website, a2zhistorypage.com, or beyondthebigscreen.com as well. I will see you next time, Beyond the Big Screen.